So look, listen at the process of learning. You experience the, what's the role of meditation according to
meditation? Yes. Meditation. First you have to ask, you have to question, what is meditation? Immediately comes to mind all of the various schools of meditation, disciplines of meditation that we are used to. The formal, the informal, the ones taught by traditional religious people, gurus, priests, around the world. It's not singular with India. Meditation is now a universal, like yoga, meditation is now a universal phenomenon. And there are whole schools of meditation. There are schools in America that are completely based on a meditative approach that comes from the Buddhist approach. And they fit everything into a meditative curriculum. So we have all of this in our traditions. So when you ask the place of meditation in a school, first you have to find out what is meditation, what is real meditation. Krishnamurti's definition of it was very different. Krishnamurti suggested that having a meditative mind was more important than a way of meditating. So for us, a meditative mind is a mind that is awake, is alert, is sensitive, doesn't concentrate. This does not exclude sitting silently in some comfortable posture, closing your eyes and being inwardly silent. That is part of it as well. But meditation, if it is to be really an important part of the child or your life, has to extend beyond a practice. Has to be something that you don't just do at 7:30 in the morning for 15 minutes because you were taught that by your grandmother, or you were in a school where you were taught that. The meditative mind is more important than the practice. So, learning how to be silent, learning how to be quiet, implies then learning all of the things that prevent being quiet, prevent being silent, where there is no inward movement. So to include meditation in your curriculum in a school means going into all of these elements about the way the mind works, the way you think, the way you listen, and why concentration is not meditative. Concentration excludes. Concentration is a form of creating conflict in the brain, because you are excluding, whether it's sound or fragrances, or whatever the senses bring into you, you're excluding that to concentrate on one thing, a word, or a feeling, or a mantra, or, you know, what traditionally we've learned. So meditation has a very large part to play in the learning process. We start all of our classes in school with silence. Every assembly, every classroom, every activity begins with 2 minutes of silence. At least 2 minutes. I noticed in Rishi Valley last week when I was there, the whole school sits in silence for 10 minutes. I think this is only possible in India. American children, European children, are, as they are now, incapable of sitting absolutely still for 10 minutes. That's still mentally, but still physically. So, understanding the body, the way the body wants to fidget and twitch and move and scratch and all the things that keep us from being still, all of that has to be gone into, has to be understood. So, we never call it meditation. We don't use that word because it has all of those historical associations. We just say, be quiet. Let's be quiet. Now, as the child grows older, this can become much more advanced. And we ask children not to come to a class to become quiet or do some activity to become quiet, but to bring quietness to the class, which means they have to be sensitive, awake, and alert to themselves. What state of mind they're in. So, a long answer for a very good question.
I somehow can understand to a certain extent that it is really important for the teachers, first of all, to be engaged in learning.
Right.
Now, what is the role of negative thinking in the matter of learning? Because I am given to understand that K did not emphasize on the positive thinking. Positive thinking is societal in nature. Mm. But he stressed upon the importance of having going through negative thinking. What it is all about, and has it got any relevance to the teachers here, to me, to all the persons here?
Right. This is an ancient, I think it's in Vedanta, I think it's in most religious, good religious traditions. Neti, to remove what is not wanted, to remove the bad, to remove what is not essential, to remove what is a distraction. So negative thinking is not the opposite of positive thinking. They're not polar opposites. And if you go into it, you can see, you'll see that they're not opposites. But in the process of meditatively or consciously or with great sensitivity and awareness, thinking about something or dealing with something, or talking about something, you are, and this is unconscious. It's what we call electric, because it happens so fast in our thinking, in our conversations, in our behavior. It's not something that you can strategize. But in the process, you are seeing where something that is not in the field, not in either the energy field or the intellectual or the psychological field of insight or understanding, it drops away, or it is set aside, or it is has no relevance, no power, no energy. And this is something that is, and I said electric because I can't think of another word for it. Krishnamurti called it insight. Well, insight, yes, but I feel, and others feel, that it is more inclusive. That is, it uses all of our senses, all seven senses. And you know five senses, but you know there are actually seven senses. And when all of those are functioning as a whole, not partially, not in isolation, but as a whole, the body is extremely sensitive. The mind is sensitive, is alert, is awake. So it is able to instantaneously, electrically, see, comprehend what is not real, what is not essential to what is happening. So Kay says neti neti, or he says negative thinking is higher than positive thinking. Those are just introductions to the process. I cannot explain it. You have to discover it. You have to see it and watch it as it happens, as you are functioning, and you see the thought that comes in, that is, you see the feeling that enters. Where it comes from is impossible to say. Asha?
What are the seven senses?
We'll do that in a minute. And I think that going further into this is a self-discovery, something that you have to see, because we live with this constantly, day in, all day. When there is the barrage of thoughts and feelings that come to us. The question?
Sir, this you're going very deep into his philosophy, which most of us also don't understand. Now, to communicate, to pass on this information to our educators, to the children and the teachers, it will take us years. I mean, I feel we also don't understand this, it's so deep. And we are, all of us, because we are associated with schools and we directly dealing with children and teachers every single day. So, you know, as Maslow's hierarchy, theory. So I'm wondering, you know, we're right at the base level right now. Now there are, I don't know if people who are sure would connect to this, is that, you know, we are struggling, and we have challenges with parents who are not interested in their children.
Yes.
Yeah.
So we are dealing directly with children every single day, very good children, very bright children who are very good with us, who are extremely nice and very, very vulnerable.
How to begin?
How to begin with them? We are struggling with that. I mean, right. Maybe with 15-20% out of the whole school, we still manage to, you know, somehow bring them to our fold. Turn them
around, say,
10-12%
still are in a
situation that
we
are not able to flip them.
Right. I can make a suggestion. This is something we did in Mexico when we were asked to come and help the school convert from the old way to a different way. And how we started, I think, is perhaps relevant. We suggested that the teachers take a few minutes out of every day and sit with the children in small groups and start to ask questions. Start a dialogue at a very basic, simple level. A dialogue on things that children are concerned with, are interested in. But all at the psychological level, not at the physical level, not dealing with, you know, their clothes and their food and their whatever, but start talking with them about things that no one probably ever does. Raising in not a complicated way, but just a simple questioning way. Why? Let's talk about this behavior. Two children have a conflict. Let's talk about it. What's happening? Not the issue that made them fight, but their response to each other. So getting them to open up about their thinking and their feeling and how their minds work without any judgment, without any evaluation, without saying that this is right and that behavior is wrong, without giving them a sense of guilt or feeling that whatever they are thinking or feeling is inappropriate, but simply to open up, to create an atmosphere of honesty and openness. I would suggest something like that to begin with the students. With the faculty, if you have interest, I wouldn't start with the whole faculty. I'd start with one or two. The ones that are seen to have the most open attitude or the most responsive to new ideas, new ways of thinking, and do a similar thing. Just open up conversations and give them things to think about and come back and discuss and talk. Give this teacher homework. Ask them to come back with what they've observed about their own children in their class, but in a different way, not academically, but psychologically. Those are just two samples. Asha asked about I mentioned the seven senses. We feel that the optimum functioning of the child requires our sensitivity as teachers to all of the functioning of the senses and helping the children to discover their senses, to begin to be aware. And when you start with this, you start completely in an academic, intellectual way by talking about it. But as the sensitivity grows, less intellectualization of this and more of the feeling level. So, you know the five that we're used to. You give them to me. Look, of sight. Yes.
Smell.
Yeah. Hearing.
Touch.
Taste. All right, those are easy ones, right? We take them for granted, but they all are part of the learning process. When they function as a whole, not isolated and separate, but when they function as a whole, it increases the sensitivity and the awareness of the child. The other two are more interesting. Number six is the vestibular sense, which has to do with the three chambers in the head, which provide us with the sense of balance. So you're walking through a narrow passage and you don't bump into the walls because your vestibular sense is keeping your body erect. When you are walking and you come to a low-hanging tree, your body knows how to adjust in height. All happens in the inner ear.
We can refer it as reflex.
It's a reflex, yes, the body automatically adjusts because it has this sense. The seventh one is the one that is only in the last perhaps 30, 40 years has even been identified, and it's called proprioception. Proprioception. And this has to do with the sense of where I am in the universe. Not simply in this room, but on a much larger scale.
Intuition is part of it. Is it something instinctive?
Any of these things can be instinctive. But it is first having the sense of our position, our place in the largest sphere possible, not simply in our immediate environment. It's a holistic sense. It's the functioning of all of the senses and the totality of our being, which includes our consciousness, includes our instinct, includes all of the senses working together and how we are positioned in time and space.
Can I get cosmic existence?
That's a fancy way of putting it.
But it also has to do with movement, proprioception.
Proprioception.
So as you move, what your position is and what position is in space, it's related to balance also.
Correct, correct.
So how do you do that?
I don't know how to do it. It happens. You have to become aware of it. And you become aware of it by increasing sensitivity and awareness in the child. So this, you know, we talked about in dealing with the handicap, children with special needs. You do sensitivity training with the handicap. You do awareness training with people who have blindness or they're deaf or whatever. So you're attempting to cultivate other senses so that they compensate. But the sense of proprioception is the functioning of all of the senses as a whole, which is required for learning. It's required for being awake and sensitive in the world. And you can illustrate the lack of this, the absence of this, in our daily behavior, because it affects the way we relate to each other, how closely we relate to someone, when you create space, when you create a distance, not only physically but psychologically, between someone, this can be traced back to proprioception. Again, the functioning of the whole. So, if interesting things, Google these and you will get more information.
In the school environment, in the classroom, how to bring about excellence in the students without competition? Because in the schools, we usually have competitions in academics, in sports. So, how to create a classroom or a school environment where we can bring about the excellence of the students,
right,
but without the sense of competition,
right,
authority.
So competition is so deeply embedded in most things that we do, whether it's games in a school or whether it's in the family, whether it's in among social groups of people, among women and their how they dress, among men and how they perform in their profession. I mean, it's deeply, deeply embedded, and it's a fact of life. It's not something that you can eliminate completely, even though it has so many negative effects when it is when you're unaware, insensitive to it. And it's such a reality that a child is, from a very early age, has to deal with it for the rest of their life. But it is possible to help children to learn that there is another way to relate non-competitively. That means doing something, being with others without a winning attitude. So you can play soccer, you can play chess, you can play a game without the attitude of hurting the other person. Because it comes down to what you will do, what means you will take to be on top, to get number one, position of number one, to score, to win, whatever it is that you're doing together. If you can help a child to play for the fun and the sake of the play, and this is so easy to do with young children, because younger children are naturally cooperative. They share. They love to help each other. It's when competition enters and they see that if you do something, you have an advantage over another. That attitude is conveyed by the teacher, by the parent. But if the teacher and the parent are sensitive to the effect of their words and their behavior and the way they're teaching, subtle, tacit competition, it can be eliminated. You sweat rather than drawing blood. You teach them to sweat, play vigorously, do whatever they are doing with tremendous energy and vitality. But it's only sweat, it's not blood. They understand that image.
It's important that you feel that you try and do the activity to the best of your ability,
right,
rather than better than anyone else.
Right.
Better than anyone else brings the competition. But if you try and do the best of your ability, the sweating is there, you work hard, you understand. You try and do the thing as good as you can, not because you want to be better than someone.
Right.
Why should a person, or a girl, a student, should endeavor for bettering himself, bettering his or her performance, if there is no competition? So this is the question. If there is no competition, why should I make any attempt to better myself?
Because of the feeling of just doing the best you can do, not better than someone.
So bring up your own potential.
Right.
The best of your own
self. Right.
Yes.
Your own ability. You are in fact working with yourself. You're not competing with others.
It is us teachers and parents, we have a habit of comparing a child's performance based on the class average and the class highest. This is where we are going wrong. I think when we send a report, it should be how a child has bettered from his previous performance. If we analyze reports like that and the achievement, what a child has achieved, the child has achieved most if he has created the maximum difference from the previous.
Right.
He's an achiever in the class. Right. Because everyone has a different potential. So if we review results in that way, I think children would excel.
Yes.
And without competing with each other, but competing with themselves.
Right. And I can give two quick suggestions. Try it. Experiment with it. First, give no grades until secondary school. No A, B, C, D, F. Remove all grades. But give written and oral reports to the child and to the parents on the accomplishments and the work that a child is doing. That changes in a child's mind. That helps to remove the competitive attitude, because then children go and compare, I've got a B and you got a C, so I'm better than you are. Second, experiment with starting to teach children how to take tests early, so that taking tests becomes a part of the learning process, not at the end of the learning process, but from the beginning. So it's one more skill. It's a skill like learning handwriting. It's a skill like learning to use test tubes in a chem lab. Taking tests is a natural part of life. It's not something to be feared, something to have to endlessly mug for or endlessly worry about. So the test taking can be incorporated into the curriculum in a different way, if your attitude towards it is different.
All my brothers and sisters here who are teaching in schools, for they are working under certain standardized environment.
Right.
Certain syllabus, all this thing. Now, they may, Harry dear, raise this question. Where is the scope for me to experiment?
This is not an experiment. We change the pedagogy in such a way that we are helping our children. Only thing is, I wanted to add here as a teacher, appreciation has to be earned. Don't go about saying, for nothing at all, yes, you're very good. So children think they don't need to do anything.
Yes. Reward is as dangerous as punishment.
Only if they do something good. Because today, everybody goes around saying, oh, very good, this smiley, that smiley. So children think without doing anything, they should be appreciated.
And sir, another big problem in India, particularly in West Bengal. Even if we are trying to do away with the grades, the media celebrates this first rank, second rank, third rank. We have a celebration of results and newspaper coverage and media coverage. That matters a lot. My photo is in the front page. I stood first in the board examination. The whole of West Bengal.
Right.
That celebration by media has to stop.
Yes.
Because that creates a competition subtly.
Yeah.
That the government should forbid the media from expressing that this boy is first among all those. Because there was a survey that the children who stood first in the board examination, after 15 years were like, they were not doing, most of them were not doing something significant.
All right.
Because Nobel laureates need not to be the first boy. Einstein was not the first boy in his class.
Right.
Thank you.
Right. The media should be for me. So
yes, they should be. Look at, India.
Go back to what you started about dialogue, when you have circle time or whatever, smaller groups.
Right.
I'm just talking from my own experience. I have been dealing with mainly with first generation learners, parents, and to them they perceive us, the institution, as dream merchants. We are going to fulfill all that they never had. And so these people come to us with that expectation. Am I ready to give that? When you have a dialogue, you have to first look within, am I prepared to accept their view of what my child should be learning. And am I able to give that? People who have not been exposed to thoughts like this, I think they need to be taken on board. As you said, in your school, the parents don't neglect, I mean, they neglect the children's,
anywhere. In parents everywhere today.
They want them to achieve.
I'm saying 95-97% of the parents are good, normal parents. They're normal kind of parents. But there are 2-3% parents who are not interested in their children.
But here we are, they are interested in, but in terms of performance, like they are not willing to accept that the child is very good in art or he's very good at swimming.
Unconventional
thing. Right. How do we, how do we sell them the idea that this is what your child is, can do that. They don't see any future in that. They don't see any future in honing his talent, but just getting marks. I face that a lot. And eventually that child turns out to be a failure in the system. So that's my main problem.
I mean, that's the problem with all of us in all our schools. It's not only first generation. I think this is a concern.
How to create the in-school knowledge and out-school knowledge. Out-of-school knowledge, that learners bring their out-of-school knowledge to school. But I think here this, the role of the educator is important. I can give one example. I have learned how to boil a little broken egg without ruining it. And I have learned it from the self-help group women, that they cook the midday.
Yes.
And I appreciate that they needed a dog. No, they needed some dough. Put it on the egg and boil it. This learning, I share with my learners that this is a great learning. Because I am trying to say, I have given up my Ikik syndrome. This Ikik syndrome is an annoying syndrome that teachers suffer from. That I know. I have given up that. And trying to bridge that out of school knowledge and in school knowledge. That gives the learner a sense of security. That, no, the knowledge that I have gathered outside the school is still valid in our school. Inside the school. If we can create that atmosphere, then only they can
leave.
The performance or the competition was being discussed. I feel, from my side, that competition is not a phenomenon just for today or 200 years or say 300 years. I think this is a, from the age period. From the cave period.
Yes.
We are carrying it forward.
Right.
And in the animal kingdom, it is also there. So we cannot put it out.
No.
So be with it comfortably. Okay. I will try to connect my children. And I am very lucky that I teach in a very rural school where there are so many first generation learners and their parents don't have really, they don't actually. Okay, pardon me, my English is not that good. They don't have such time to think about those children, whether they are doing well or not, they cannot measure. Only the thing they can measure that, okay, they ensure they are coming to school for the midterm also. It's very important. Now, I can make an environment where the parameters can be changed. Okay, you are not doing well in mathematics, maybe you are doing well in art and craft or whatever your knowledge that is alcohol. You are having something, everything in an alternative concept which I have to bring out and I have to make a bridge because what I am having as syllabus in my book and I am not supposed to transfer it. I am just supposed to relate it whatever you know as per your bringing up. Whatever you are telling,
we should play the role of a facilitator.
Facilitator, because he and she, the children who are sitting in front of me, they are also capable of delivering something which is not in my parameter. I am measuring him or her by English, mathematics, or such disciplines, which maybe he or they are not up to. But they are some, there are scopes, there should be scopes, there should be some detailed parameters from which we have to choose, so that more and more children find their spheres where they are excellent. We are having the the result mark sheet, where actually 6 or 7 or 8 subjects are given, and for that the numbers and the gradations are done. And in our West Bengal board, there are 6 or 7 abilities, like empathy, like cooperation,
collaboration.
Yes, they are written in the left of the mark sheet, and we don't care for those subjects.
Yes.
And we don't even, we don't even find the child who is the best in empathy, say empathy, or say cooperation, or say.
So this can be, education has to change.
This can be for that child who is who has got B in each subjects, but he has excelled in cooperation or say empathy.
Right.
He should be noticed, and he should be encouraged.
Right.
So I have a point of view here.
Please.
Is the biggest challenge we face is teachers. You mentioned a while ago the teacher, the educator, learning first himself or herself before we reach out to our children. The biggest concern we have is teachers nowadays are only concerned with syllabus completion. How much time are teachers spending with their students, hearing them, listening to them on things beyond subject and syllabus? And I think a lot to do with that is also our teacher training. All these qualities that you're talking about, empathy, child psychology, should be a very important component of the teacher training program, because our teachers do not know how to go about it. And when we talk to our teachers and we tell them that, okay, certain lessons today you're only going to relate and talk about, listen to your students, observe them in informal environments. You get to know a lot about body language when you observe them.
This could be the continuation of our earlier discussion.
Right.
We are talking about that the teacher's training program. One is the curriculum or the activities, normal activities, and the psychological part. We stop at that point. Psychological, incorporating the psychological part in teacher's training.
Right.
If you can elaborate something on a point here.
Right. It's going to take acts of God or multiple gods to change this at the level where it needs to be changed. So where you can begin is your own classroom, your own school, your own school head, and in that sphere you can begin to make changes. You perhaps will be considered subversive or revolutionary. Doesn't matter. If you feel strongly that you have to change the orientation in the classroom, in the structure of the syllabus, experiment with it. Try it. Take your head, your school head, or your division head, or whoever you have to report to and who you have to work with, and bring them with you. Attempt to get them to cooperate with you. This may be difficult. You may have to do things sub rosa for some time before you can get that cooperation. But at least begin. At least start somewhere. You may find that there are other teachers who will join you. You may find a few parents who will understand the language you're using and the approach that you're suggesting. Begin small. Begin simply. You just change what you can change. Don't wait for God. Don't wait for Modi and the Department of Education to be different. Begin at home.
Some of us have been, I wouldn't say successful completely, but we've been trying for a lot of years. Now it's been
13, 14, 15 years we've been trying continuously.
Right.
And now we do see that there's a little change. I wouldn't say it's changed completely, but we are seeing a little change. And also, what we realize is we've got to, first, identify teachers who need more help. And then in small groups, we've got to do it. Plus, what we do is, so teachers are sent for training, their in-house training. Plus, we also have 10 days of complete monitoring. We have orientation sessions every year at the beginning of the academic session. So 10 days, we do nothing but train each other, and we all know the students and learn from each other.
Right.
So that's what we've been doing, and every, of course, working Saturday, we don't get time to meet with teachers on a regular basis. So working Saturday, we meet maybe once or twice a month.
Mm-hmm.
And then we do that. It's, we don't bring people, we do bring people from outside very often, but we also try and learn from each other. As I said, we're facing the same.
I think it's just
it's the same space. Yes,
creating that culture gradually.
We're just trying. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
We have a third addition. All schools is the parents. The parent addition. You try your best in the school, and it's the parents who want to oppose anything good that you want to do, just for the sake of opposition.
Yeah.
I mean, we're trying to encourage responsibility in children, reduce the carbon footprint, stop them from driving down to the school. We have a private pathway where they can walk down. We've got so many complaints, why will you make my child walk down to school? I mean,
but
sense
half of
the
time, I think, goes in combating parents.
Yes.
Instead
yes.
of spending that time in our school with our students,
very demanding.
A lot of our time is going in all these issues.
You know, that's
justifying
why,
what we
that's
are
That's why I raised the question, you know. I think when you take them together, like three parts of a triangle,
yes,
take them on board.
Yes.
And do. Sell them the idea that we do in it together.
Right.
I think that.
See, what you're trying to do is create a whole environment for the child, so that what the parents value at home is in some way consistent with what the school values, and vice versa. So that the poor child is not caught in the middle of two opposing. Right. You want to minimize that. In any possible way. This implies then that you have to bring the parents in with you whenever you make changes, whenever you're trying to help the child do something, involve the parent, even if they oppose you. But they begin to understand what you're attempting to do. There's a value system, the culture, the conditioning of culture is so powerful, so strong, in a completely different direction, that you are faced with an enormous, enormous challenge. But it's not so different in other parts of the world. It just seems formidable here. But believe me, the whole of mankind is facing this kind of indifference, lack of participation, lack of consideration. And it remains for a long time to be part of the education process.
Sir, I have another question.
Please.
In the present, one of the most important problems is climate crisis.
Yes.
How does A's teaching help us to become aware of the climate crisis? Because already 7 countries have declared climate emergency.
Right.
The anthropogenic global heating is going to create climate change and that's obvious. But we are not. The people of the who are living in the coastal areas are the most vulnerable. But there is, people are so much engrossed in development that people are forgetting about climate crisis, and since our government has not declared climate emergency, we are doing nothing but climate change. We are plunging the climate.
Our environment.
Then how can we make people aware of this climate crisis?
Oh. I'm afraid there is no way out. I'm afraid that it is a you know, the Greek myth of Sisyphus. Sisyphus pushes a ball up the hill, and as far as she goes, she falls back, and she keeps pushing. We are in that position. The climate crisis, the lack of...
Economic crisis.
It's everything. Absolutely everything. We have to work in the sphere that we can work, which is in the minds of the few little ones we have with us. We're not going to change the government. We're not going to change the community. We can change a few children that we're responsible for. I have what? Yes.
We can also have in our country.
Yes.
We don't allow. This is the problem of our education system or whatever you you can interpret it just like that. And when a girl in my school or when a girl in any surrounding schools or in a family, we won't allow our girls to shout like that.
But
let the boy also not shout at the girls.
Yes, you can still.
Yes, protest.
Can I finish this one thing? I've got to stop. I'm being given the signal. let me say, we look to icons. Greta is an icon. She symbolizes something. Younger generation standing up strongly. I would suggest that in our sphere, in this country, we don't have to worry about finding one person. We can have each and every student in our school become a champion for a cause or a different way of thinking. Let every child, they don't need to get on television, they don't need to be publicly acclaimed. They can, in their own families, in their own school, in their own environment, be champions for a different way of living, a different way of thinking. I would work on the whole...
I can remember the whole competitive sport. Unfortunately, in the country that needs a hero.
Right.
Sir, I want to add something. She was talking about, you know, awareness about the climate. In our college, we are having a danger awareness program. In which the students are conducting a survey in their residential neighborhood, and they're giving us reports, which are getting analyzed by professors of the zoology and botany departments. And then they are doing some awareness campaigns, especially around our college, in the hostels, and in the slum areas. And on Saturday, we are having a program. So that has made the students become more involved with, you know, the concerns in our state, or rather in our city, and the examples which are there in the Western world, that is inspiring them. Now more students are coming up to participate in the NSS scheme, which is National Social Service. So they are volunteering quite a lot, and especially girls.
Wonderful.
So that is...
Sounds very good. Yeah.
I think my little contribution is basically this thing of competition. It seems like it's big, but it's very simple. If you use the same skills to make them understand that this is to understand the subject better and to communicate better, rather than do it better than her, but to do it as much as I understand myself. And as a teacher also, if you can say that, yes, we've given this sort of questionnaire, not to judge you, not to mark you individually, but to understand where you need help, where you are lacking understanding in the subject. And that should be the modus, and not the doing the best.
And try to make the students more involved in the classroom by making them perform peer teaching, present very small papers, which we try to do right from first year of college. So that makes them more interested in the subject.
Right.
And that also boosts their confidence. Even the below average students, it helps them. to, you know, take on more active roles in class, because the good ones will do well. So I try to select average students for class presentation, so that, you know, that spikes off their interest in the subject.
Maybe take both kinds.
We'll have the chance after the with the journalist interaction. I just want to conclude
I'm here to listen from you. We were all teachers, and I'm here not to comment. But that particular point that she made about the climate awareness. Now what to be done about climate changes and all those problems. One thing that I would suggest, I'm again telling you that I'm not to make any comment, but that's my suggestion, that's my views on this, is that be the change you want to see in the world.
Yes.
You first become the change yourself. What I can do for myself, that is the starting point I should make. I think it should be the fact. And I have been searching this particular question about, say, 10 years back, 10 to 15 years back. I started, what could be done about it? And the answer that I got from is that it may seem not very sophisticated, but it is that it is an alternative and vegan lifestyle. That it came, it was a rereading of Mahatma Gandhi's autobiography. It starts with your tongue.
Yeah.
You said this.
Right.
Where the change should start? From the restricted way of lifestyle. It should start from your tongue. He said
that. Right. Yes, that's a good point.
Just to say, because I think quite a few are, you know, need to go over there, in Calcutta also, some of the people from Orissa. Just wanted to thank Martha. One of the things I marvel at, I think yesterday he has had a very, very busy day, busy schedule, and he's coping with it exceptionally. So the reason why it's so good, because I think this year we've had a chance to do something that we in Calcutta have been trying to do. We are not educators, but we want to be catalysts in some way. Get things together and do something. So if there are ideas that come from you, I think we can actually feed it into the system. Like last time we got two very good educators to run a program in July. We could do something else depending on what those ideas are. And for the moment, I think if you need to buy books, the bookstore is there. And Mark's latest book, the biography, is there. And if you want it signed by him, he's available to sign. And after that, please,
thank you for coming.